Thank you, and good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship on this fifth Sunday of Easter. We'd like to begin with our choral introit, as always. I'll ask you to remain seated, but let us sing together and prepare our hearts for worship. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Good morning. If you'll join me in the call to worship as found on your screens. As the sun rises in the morning,
let all creation worship God.
From the highest mountains to the deepest seas,
let all creation proclaim the name of the Lord, for God alone is worthy to be praised.
God alone makes all things new.
All praise, glory, and honor be yours forever.
And if you'll pray the opening prayer with me. Gracious and loving God, you meet us where we are. We gather together from many walks of life, but we are unified as one heart in the body of Christ. In our time of worship, open our ears to hear your voice. Open our eyes to see your glory. Open our minds to receive your word. Open our hearts to perceive your presence. Amen. And our opening hymn this morning is God is Here. The words are found on your screen. And if you're in the sanctuary this morning, you can find it in your hymnal on page 660. If you'll stand as able, please.
And we're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4, so you know.
Thank you.
each and all of you. Welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday morning. Well, I'm glad to say that I can say beautiful because I was driving in. It was really cloudy and very foggy. So it is a beautiful day. And as you know, that we have a special event coming up later too. So we're so excited that for all God's people to be able to be here together. And this morning, I'm very delighted to have my colleagues and friends. I like to call you friends. But anyway, Reverend Rhonda and Reverend Dave. And I was asking, well, I've been asking you to come maybe share a message for a long time, but it turned out finally things worked out despite your busy schedule. So I thank you for that. And I was asking, they have combined of 70 years of ministry experience in many different settings. So I have so much to learn from you both, and I hope that we all might hear something new insight or whatever, that so we might together grow. And I was joking that maybe you two can do it together, like maybe dialogue, or maybe you do half and you do half. And obviously, they are going to bring us message in a very unique way this morning. So I'm looking forward to that as well. So thank you for being here. So now we like to come to that time of prayer. I know we come to this place with many prayer concerns or requests that we carry in our hearts. So now let us open our hearts and together let us go to God in prayer. Oh God, we give you thanks on this new day that you have given us. With possible, new ways to encounter you, new ways to embrace your grace, perhaps new direction you would guide us go, and new ways for us to honor you, ensure your love, and share that with others. So thank you for giving us this new day, and thank you for calling each and all the persons out of many different walks of life to this place so that we as one people in Christ Jesus, we are able to worship you, pray to you, and hear one another's concerns as well as joys. And then we will be able to grow together in loving you and serving you and all your people. So we thank you. Be with us and lead this time together. And may the power of the Holy Spirit mysteriously touch our hearts and our lives so that we can continue to live the life of faith, not just on Sundays, but all the days of our lives. God, in this life, we encounter so many unknowns or grief, tragedy, or things that struggle makes us struggle. Yet, God, you are with us all along the way. So may we always have eyes to see your guiding hands, your presence, and the peace that you provide for all of us. And may we always glorify your name in our words, in our actions, in our compassion towards others. Be with us at this time, in our lives, and all the day. God, we're here this morning with many prayer concerns, requests, or petitions that we may carry in our hearts. So now we'd like to lift those up to you. Lord, hear our prayer.
Walt Cunningham, Ronnie Light, John Burrell,
Ruby,
Evangeline Moxley,
the joy of music, the gift of healing.
God, we give you thanks that you hear our prayers, both the ones that were voiced out loud, as well as the ones that remain in our hearts. We trust that you'd answer them in your timely manner, in your special ways. This morning, God, we continue to lift up all those who might be facing health challenges, going through treatments or recovering from recent procedures. All those who might be facing other struggles or challenges in life. Those who are facing uncertainty for the future. Those who are feeling weary and stressed. Those who might be feeling lonely and needing friends or communities to belong. We continue to lift up all schools, students, teachers, and staff, especially during this graduation season. Especially remember all the graduates for their accomplishments and their future. We also remember all those who serve others in many different capacities, including medical professionals, first responders, and all others. Remember all the peacemakers, especially in this broken world, broken community that we live in. We give them thanks for their presence and their tireless work to unite people. Remember Greenwood Church and all the persons who are part of this community. You have brought us here out of many different walks of life, and you have called us one people in Christ's name. May we always serve you and all your people in this community and beyond. Please continue to guide us, both as individuals and as a congregation. We remember all the persons in the community, in the country, and the world. Again, we continue to lift up all the places where there is people are experiencing violence, war, divisions, hatred, misunderstanding of any kinds. I just ask that you will continue to be in our lives and in the world, life of the world, that we might embrace your love, your peace, and your hope. So God, let us, the God's people, let us come together and pray together the Lord's Prayer, just as Jesus taught us to pray, by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. So now I'd like to invite each and all of you to come together and recite together the Apostles' Creed. If you're able, please stand and let us together say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Well, this morning we are so delighted to have our choir back, who is bringing us a special music this morning.
God, you are my
On the, what is it, third Sunday of the month, and they'll practice Wednesday prior, so
until September.
So yeah, if you'd like to join and share your beautiful voices, please, I will remind you about the practice and all that. But thank you so much, choir. So now we come to the time in worship that we share special things that are happening through our photos and story, whatnot. I will go ahead and bring that back to you, Ashley. Would you please talk about the first slide for us?
Sure. So for Mother's Day, we took Mom out to Camden Yards and Heather, too, the two mothers in our family. And we went to the Orioles game from Mother's Day last Sunday. So we missed you all here, but that's where we were. And so the whole family went, and we had a good time. They got special Mother's Day hats. The Oriole bird actually came up to our section, and we finally, all these years we've been going, we finally got to meet the Oriole bird. And then if you can see there in the top right corner of the slide, the Oriole bird brought his mother to the game for Father's Day as well. So that's him walking with his mother. So we had a great time. It was fun. We got to spend a lot of time with family, and that's what it's all about. So. It was cold. It was chilly.
I can tell by the way you guys dressed. It was a chilly day, but I'm glad that you guys had a wonderful time. And that's so neat that he brought his mother. So that's great. All right. Next photo that you're seeing from the comes from the Kinnaman family. They had a wonderful time in, I don't remember, Greenbrier something, Braille Road or something like that. It's in West Virginia. I think I've never been. But anyway, they got to see the caboose, and the picture on the right, I was hoping that Erin would be here to explain exactly where it is, but that they had a wonderful family adventure together. So, thank you for sharing those photos and all the joys. Next picture came from Kim Renner. So she and her friend's son, Andrew, got married back in April, I believe, in Richmond. So congratulations to Andrew and Stephanie, the wife. And Kim said that they, Stephanie had two children from previous relationships. And so Kim became a grandmother of two. So that's the picture, the family photo that you see on the right-hand side. So congratulations and many blessings to both and all the families. One more of a wonderful joy that we are able to share this morning. Our Sarah Alder graduated from Virginia Tech this past Friday, I believe. So congratulations to Sarah. Yay! So Kevin told me that they're going to go on family vacation to have a wonderful, relaxing time together. So he will be missing the next couple of Sundays, but he wanted to send those photos so that we might be able to share the joy together. If I'm not mistaken, Sarah plans to continue in the graduate school, I believe at Radford, if I'm not mistaken, to continue her study. So many blessings once again to Sarah, and I'm hoping that she'll be here one Sunday in June so that we might be able to celebrate her accomplishment together as a church people. So, and in the evening at 5 o'clock, we're gonna get to hear awesome music by Connor Kratzer. He is recovered and well. So he's going to have a benefit recital. His main theme is spring, but he's prepared to do a classical music, modern music, theater music, and more. So I'm so excited. So if you're able to come, please come. And if you're able to donate all the proceeds, we're going to send to AMCOR, United Methodist Committee on Relief for the people in Ukraine. So wonderful music for a wonderful cause. So I hope to see you there. Next couple of slides, I would like to invite Ms. Tammy Light to speak.
So the first slideshow, it's the day that we make the props for Vacation Bible School. We meet at First Presbyterian Church, and they've graciously invited us to join up with them. So the more help that we can get to make the props, the quicker it'll go. And please trust me, you do not have to be crafty. I am the least craftiest person ever, and I can do it. And they make it a lot of fun, and they provide pizza for us for lunch. Great opportunity. And as you can see in the slideshow, the decorations are phenomenal. I mean, they're just awesome.
Yeah, the pictures are from the past Bible school's decoration. So as you see, it's awesome. The whole place is going to turn into whatever the theme of that year. Is that for the shipwreck, I believe? The big one?
That's from shipwreck.
Yeah. So you see the big boat and everything. And this year's theme is called Monumental. Yeah. That's the theme of this year. Would you like to speak again?
So, yeah, this year it's Monumental. And I will have registration forms for you. It's for anybody. If you have grandchildren, next door neighbors, nieces, nephews. We open up our church that week for any child. And Vacation Bible School is extremely important to the children because it gives them an opportunity to learn about Jesus. And it gives us, the adults, an opportunity to get to know the children in our community. So once I get the registration forms, I will pass them out to you and just invite as many people as you can.
Great. Thank you so much, Ms. Tammy. And we will go ahead and let you know about the details about the time. But at least those dates are already set, so please mark your calendar now. And if you are able to help, they're needing a lot of volunteers in any ways, as to providing snacks, to just being there and, kind of being a good presence of peace, you know. So anybody can help in any way. So please come talk to Ms. Tammy if you'd like to help. And last but not least, Ashley, would you like to speak this again?
Yeah, so we planned a movie night for the community. We're looking for ways to try to bring the community to the church, try to get more interest in the church. We know that there's a lot of new houses and new complexes coming about in this area, and we're trying to draw in some of the community from that. So one of the ideas was to have an outdoor movie night. I just got approval this week, so we have the license, we're ready to go. The movie that we picked is Encanto. It's one of the newer Disney films, so we were hoping because it's newer, it would draw more interest in. So we're going to have it's going to be outdoors, we're going to have a screen set up, bring your chairs. I got the speakers in, they're amazing. And then we're going to start it at 8 o'clock, it'll probably be around 8:30, 8:45, depending on how dark it is. Before we actually start the movie, but we're going to have like a pre-movie event. So we're going to have Just Dance on so the kids can dance, get some energy out. But it's for kids and adults alike. Everybody, invite everybody that you know. We're going to have popcorn. We're planning on making cotton candy. So it's going to be a real fun time. So we'll start getting the word out. But 8 o'clock, June 24th, it's a Friday night.
Thank you so much, Ashley. And I just wanted to thank you to you for all the work that you brought into this. I mean, it's not an easy, it's not like, you know, I have a DVD, so let's play. No. Especially Disney wouldn't allow that. So you have to really have to purchase the right to show that in public. And there's some limitation of what we can do, what we cannot do and all that. And she has gone through all that. So thank you, Ashley, for all the work to make this event happen. So now let us bring our two of our special friends, Paisley and Froggy, for a special puppet show this morning.
Paisley, come up here right now.
Froggy, I'm not coming up until you say please and stop being so bossy.
Oh, that's a good one. Rule number 3,795. Everyone else has to say please except me.
What? Rule number 3,799?
No, rule number 3,795. I wanted to tell you about some new rules around here.
I can't remember 3,000 rules.
3,795 rules. And rule number 1,821 says, forgetting the rules is not allowed.
You're not being very nice, Froggy.
Oh, yes. Don't forget rule number 3. If you keep all the rules, then I will let you be my friend.
Well, that's interesting. What's rule number 1?
Rule number 1 is, Froggy is always right.
But what if you're wrong?
That's covered by rule number 2. If Froggy is ever wrong, see rule number 1.
Froggy is always right. Yeah, I'm sure glad God doesn't have rules like you.
Yeah, he had less than 700.
No, that's not what I mean. He had different kinds of rules.
Like what?
Like serious ones. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal.
Oh, those are good ones. Rule number 3,796. Killing Froggy is not allowed. Rule number 3,797. Stealing from Froggy is not allowed.
I think your rules are a little twisted.
So what's wrong with my rules? I like them.
Well, take rule number 3, for instance.
Rule number 3. If you keep all the rules, then I will let you be my friend.
Yeah, God's not like that. We get to be God's children because he loves us, not because we keep his rules.
But if you don't keep his rules, then he should punish you.
Well, of course, if we do something bad here on earth, we'll still get in trouble. But God doesn't make us quit being his children. Froggy, Jesus died for all of us to make us his children.
Then why do you keep his rules at all then?
Because we love him and because his rules are good for us.
I think all my rules are good. Everyone has to do everything to make me feel good. Like rule number 78. If I want what you have, then you have to give it to me.
Froggy, they're good for you, but they're only good for you. God's rules are good for everyone. Jesus said the greatest rule is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And the second rule is to love your neighbor as yourself. And that's all you need to remember. We should all love each other.
So we should keep God's rules because we love him.
Yes.
And we love him because he made us his children.
Yes.
And what makes us his children is not how many rules we keep.
Yes.
What makes us his children is following Jesus.
Yes, you got it.
I really did know that already. Well, I guess you convinced me, Paisley. I'm going to use God's rules. I like you, Paisley.
I like you too, Froggy.
And you don't have to call me, oh, most wonderful and beneficent majesty either, unless you want to.
Froggy! Oh.
That was rule number 2,314, if you were wondering.
Oh, brother!
Well, kids, I guess we learned that the only rules you need to remember is to love God and Jesus with all your hearts and to love those around you so they can see Jesus in you.
Hey, Froggy, I've been reading that list of rules you gave me and I don't think I can keep all of them.
Well, that's okay, Lucas. I decided I didn't need all those rules anyway. I just need to remember to love God with all my heart and to show everyone around me love, too.
Oh, that's easy to remember. I can remember that, too.
Great! Well, have a good week, kids. We'll see you again real soon.
Bye!
Thank you so much. And all the children, I would like to go with Miss Peggy to downstairs for a special program. Thanks. I don't think I can remember all that many rules, but good for him that he does. All right, quick reminder that the your giving, tithe, and offering can be mailed to the church, or there's the offering basket that placed in the back of the sanctuary. So now please join me as we dedicate those gifts back to the Lord. Oh God, we give you thanks for the many gifts that you give to us in many different ways. Let us never take those for granted, but always have a heart of thanksgiving to you. It is time for us to bring those gifts back to you. We pray that you would accept our gifts, bless our gifts, and use our gifts for the many ministries that you may have here on earth. May our gifts be glorified your name. We thank you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So please join me in a prayer for illumination found on the screen. Let us pray this together. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
Our first scripture lesson this morning is from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30, verses 11 through 20. Surely this commandment that I am commanding you today is not too hard for you, nor is it too far away. It is not in heaven that you should say, "Who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us, so that we may hear it and observe it?" Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, "Who will cross to the other side of the sea for us and get it for us, so that we may hear it and observe it?" No, the word is very near to you. It is in your mouth and in your heart for you to observe. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall certainly perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob.
Good morning. The second scripture lesson comes from John chapter 21, verses 1 through 14. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them, and though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now, none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. The word of God for the people of God.
Good morning, Greenwood.
Good morning.
We are so grateful to Pastor Keiko for her invitation, challenging invitation as it was, to come and bring the word to you today.
It was, as she said, it was her idea for us to do this together, right?
Never done this before.
And so this is a first for us. So here it goes. Okay. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times.
That's not very original, but we're going with it. It was the age of wisdom. It was the age of foolishness.
It was the epic of belief.
It was the epic of incredulity.
It was the season of light.
It was the season of darkness.
It was the spring of hope.
It was the winter of despair.
We had everything before us.
We had nothing before us.
We were all going direct to heaven.
We were all going direct the other way. Now, Charles Dickens wrote those words describing the end of the 1700s, but I think they could be said of our times. Best of times, worst of times. We are in this worldwide roller coaster. And frankly, this past week was a rough week.
Or was it a great week? It depends on whose voice you are listening to. Some of the noisiest voices insist on cranking up the intensity, ratcheting up the anxiety. The sensational is what makes the headlines. And there's the using the superlatives, the worst, the most. This is the worst shape the world has ever seen. This is the most polarized the world has ever been. We are on the edge of World War III, the global pandemic, racial violence, climate change, the economy, baby formula, for goodness sake, all the worst. There's no arguing that things are challenging, uncertain. But are they the worst they've ever been?
I sometimes wonder what our great-grandparents would say about that. Were their times better or worse than our times? I mean, they witnessed slavery. They saw our nation splinter in a civil war.
And what would our grandparents say? They endured the pandemic of their time. They saw two world wars and raised families through the Depression. What would they say about these times? Better? Worse?
And our parents. I remember very clearly as a child watching the first lunar landing with my dad. And he marveled. Like he would say, his father, he said, imagine this, your grandfather in his lifetime saw the world go from horse and buggy to car to plane to space travel. That always impressed my dad. My dad believed in progress, that things could get better and better over time. But I remember the year before the landing, Dad and I also watched the assassination of a civil rights leader and watched in D.C. just over the mountain, the city in flames. For so many reasons, I wish my dad was still here. And I wonder, I'd like to ask him what he would say about this, the best of times, the worst of times.
He might tell us to look at the whole picture. He might tell us not to lose sight of how the world has actually been getting better.
Yes, he would definitely want us to fact check. So for example, the rate of poverty in our world is actually going down. On the current track, by the year 2030, no one in the world will still be living below the current poverty level. That's progress. Illiteracy is declining. Violent crimes, believe it or not, if you fact check it, violent crimes are way down over the last decades. Child labor has declined. My dad believed in progress, and he thought it was an amazing time to be alive right up until his death. If you were to say, what one wish do you have? He would say, I wish I could go back and do it all over again.
So are these the worst of times or the best of times?
My opinion, things could definitely be better. But I would caution us against comparing all these sensational headlines of the present to some kind of rose-tinted or whitewashed version of the past. What I do feel confident saying is these are uncertain times. We all feel the insecurity. And if you want, I could list all the reasons for us to feel insecure.
No, please don't. Please don't. It'll only make it worse. Just watching the news already has made me feeling like this apocalypse and waiting.
I'm with you. And despite the reports of gloom and doom, in the church, we as Christians, we are still in the season of Easter. 50 days looking straight into the face of the resurrection. The resurrection of Jesus Christ says the worst of times don't get the last word. The resurrection of Christ says in the battle of death and life, life wins. Christ has conquered death. Light shatters darkness. And tombs are only temporary.
Today's text takes us to the first Easter. And perhaps if we study it together, it can give us clues as to about how to live in this insecure times. We encourage you to find the Pew Bible, if you have that before you, and turn to chapter 20.
Yeah, we're starting a little earlier before what Ashley read. I believe it's on page 768 of your Pew Bible, and some of you might have your own. Follow along, and don't be afraid to shout out an answer to a question or two. So this morning, we're going to the Gospel of John. We're going to have a John's eye view of the story. We're going to look only at accounts that appear in the Gospel of John. Y'all know that each Gospel tells the story of the resurrection a little bit differently. In John's version, chapter 20, it is not the women who go to the tomb. It is one woman. What's your name?
Mary. Which Mary? Mary, the mother of Jesus? Mary, who was the sister of Mary and Martha and Lazarus? Mary Magdalene? Some different Mary?
Set him straight. Fact check him. Mary Magdalene, that's right. So early in the morning, Mary Magdalene gets to the tomb, and she sees that the stone has been removed, and she immediately runs back to where some of the disciples are. It's like they are in hiding, but the text doesn't specifically say that. And she goes to two disciples. Which ones? Peter and the one Jesus loved.
I thought Jesus loved them all.
I'm sure Jesus did love all of his disciples, but there's this tradition that the youngest disciple, young John, was the beloved disciple, and that Jesus asked John to care for his mother Mary. And so sometimes he's called the beloved disciple. So when Mary Magdalene gets to Peter and John, what does she tell them, Dave?
It is the best of times. Jesus is risen?
No. She doesn't know that yet. You got to fact check. All she knows so far is that the stone has been removed. And she interprets that one single fact. And she says, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where that they have put him. These are the worst of times.
Now wait. If she only saw the stone rolled away, how did she come up with that worst-case assumption? Does she suspect, like, grave robbers?
Dave, fear does strange things to our thinking. When we are anxious, when we are insecure, and we don't have clear information, we connect the dots, and sometimes we draw the wrong conclusions. For Mary, she saw the stone moved and right away went to the worst-case thinking.
Well, how did she make that leap? I mean, was there some kind of surge trend of grave robbing in the first century Jerusalem?
No. Fact check it. Google it, David. Google it. So she tells them the body has been moved, and Peter and the disciple start running for the tomb. Who gets there first, Dave?
That's a no-brainer. The young one gets there first.
Yeah, the young one outruns Peter. And so what does the young one see when he runs into the tomb?
Look at your Bible.
Actually, that's a trick question.
Oh.
He doesn't run in. John stops short of the goal line, and he peeks in, and he sees their strips of linen from the burial. And Peter?
Peter catches up and bursts in like it's going for a touchdown. Classic Peter.
Right, right. And what does Peter say?
Christ is risen indeed. Best of times.
No, Peter said nothing.
And the young guy?
The young guy eventually did go into the tomb, but the text says he didn't understand, yet he believed. And then the two of them went off together to proclaim Christ risen to the uttermost parts of the earth, right?
I'm feeling kind of insecure myself. I mean, I refuse to answer the question on the grounds that it might embarrass me.
Yeah, we don't want to take quizzes on these Bible stories. All the details are important. They did not go and proclaim. Somebody tell them what they did. What'd they do?
They went back to Jerusalem.
Yes, they went back to where they were staying. Mary Magdalene, though, she remained at the tomb crying. And when she bent over to look inside, she saw two angels who asked her, "Why are you crying?" And she told them her grave robbery theory. She had come to believe it herself. And when she turned around to leave, someone asked her the same question again. "Why are you crying?" And she doubled down on her story. She stuck with it, thinking that this was the gardener. But then he said her name, Mary. And she got it. It woke her up. It was Jesus risen. And she went back to the disciples and told them what she had seen. So in John's gospel, that's the first time the risen Christ appears. But later that day, Jesus appears to almost all of the disciples. And they're kind of dazed and they're behind locked doors. A week later, he appears to remove all doubts from Thomas. And in John's gospel, the risen Christ just keeps showing up. Which takes us to our lesson today in 21.
No more questions, okay?
Okay, but stay curious about the story. Don't just assume things, all right?
Okay.
So we don't know how long after the resurrection the story in John 21 happens. So let's just say it's a couple of weeks. And the disciples are still together. Maybe they're still in hiding. Maybe they're dazed. They're definitely insecure. They don't know what to believe, or even if they believe, they don't know what to do about it. They're afraid for their lives, for their survival. I'm not saying they're panicking. Instead, as I read the situation, they're kind of paralyzed, stuck. They're living at this intersection of contradictions. On one hand, you got a dead body. And on the other hand, you got these resurrection appearances. You've got Hallelujah, joy, and fear for their future. You got the best of times, but you kind of got the worst of times. Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt caught in the middle of things you know are true, but feeling stuck about what to do next?
No, just this week. Do I fill the car when the price is like this, or just put in what I need and hope for the best when the future is so uncertain?
Or inflation. Do I buy eggs now while they're high, or wait till next week when they could be higher?
Rising interest rates. Do we move forward planning on a house, or just give it up because the rates are so climbing?
Investments. Do I even look at what has happened to every penny I have ever managed to save, or do I just like close my eyes and cover my ears?
Or I've got an idea. We gather all of our spare change and buy crypto. We haven't even mentioned the pandemic in Ukraine.
Pause for a breath.
These are uncertain times, insecure times. And you can work yourself up from stress to frenzy.
In the midst of lingering Easter insecurity, what does Peter do? Check your text. What does Peter do? What does he say?
Where does he go? What does he do? What is he familiar with?
Yeah, fishing. I heard somebody say it. He says, I'm going fishing.
And that has always just really kind of fascinated me. Was it like the old shopkeeper hanging up the gone fishing sign and just checking out and going off for the day?
That seems unlikely to me. Do y'all remember what Peter did for a living before he met Jesus? He was a fisherman, yeah. And Jesus called him, leave your nets, come and follow me. So now in insecure times, Peter goes back to what he knows. He goes back to the nets.
So into the night, Peter goes to the familiar and the others following.
Dave, what do you think Peter thought about that night?
Is that a trick question? Does it say, tell us in the text?
No. It doesn't say in the text. I'm just asking you, I'm wondering, have you ever imagined in a night full of fishing without catching a thing what Peter was thinking about?
I imagine he was thinking back on his times with Jesus, going over it all, trying to make sense of it all. He's thinking back to when he first saw that traveling teacher. He's remembering the miraculous teaching and healing. He's letting it all kind of sink in.
Do you think all of his memories were positive?
No, I really don't. Memories are never all positive, are they? Peter likely remembered times when with his impulsive side just kind of took over. Times when he just burst in. Once Jesus even said, get behind me, Satan. That was Peter, right?
Right, that was Peter.
Just fact checking, the Google thing, you know. And then there was the night he cut off the ear of the soldier who was taking Jesus away.
Yeah, now that was pretty impulsive, even for Peter.
But later that same night, he didn't rush in.
What do you mean?
Well, later that night, Peter and the other disciple followed Jesus after the arrest. The other disciple went right into the high court, but Peter lingered behind. Some of the guards made a fire made out of charcoal, and Peter warmed himself there. The girl who watched the door asked him if he knew Jesus. Someone else did, and then a third person, a relative of the guy with the ear, all pushing the issue. Three times, Peter had opportunity to name and proclaim Jesus, but he didn't.
And so you think he was thinking about that the night they were all fishing?
I do. I imagine his regrets were like waves. He thought about his denials through the evening watch and the midnight watch and the cockcrow watch.
But as the dawn watch came, something disrupted his all-night rumination. A figure on the shore cried out, children, haven't you any fish?
Yeah, I always wondered about that, how that really went over with a bunch of exhausted fishermen. To have some smart aleck knowing you all on the shores trying to beach chair quarterback what they've been doing all their lives. I imagine they had some few choice words to say.
Well, actually, if you look at the text, they only said one word in answer to this question. They just said no.
But I bet they mumbled a few things that just actually didn't make it into the Bible.
Maybe so. Maybe so. But he instructed them to throw their nets on the right side of the boat.
Wait. What right?
What do you mean, what right?
I mean, did he say throw your net on the right side of the boat as opposed to the left side of the boat? Or did he throw your net on the right side like the correct side because they had been fishing on the wrong side as opposed to the right side?
Who's on first? Dave, Google it, okay?
I'll Google the Greek.
The Greek?
The Greek word for right?
Right. Okay. When the fishermen adjusted their nets, so many fish came to them that they couldn't even haul the net the whole way into the boat. And something about that moment wakes Peter, awakens him to the identity of the one who was yelling from the shore.
I have a theory.
What about?
About what woke Peter. But it's not there in the text.
Tell us anyway. Try out your theory on us.
Okay. I imagine the last time Peter saw that many fish was on the hillside when Jesus was teaching and all the disciples had to feed more than 5,000 people was 5 loaves and 2 fish. And somehow it was enough.
I like that. Maybe that's what woke Peter, the memory of Jesus and all those fish. And so from the boat, Peter proclaims, "It is the Lord!"
And then he jumps in and swims to shore.
Actually, he does something before he jumps in. All night he's been stripped down to his skivvies for fishing, and the text says he puts on his clothes and then he jumps in. Do you know why he did that?
No, why?
I have no idea.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe when you're as overwhelmed as he was and feeling insecure as we all do, maybe you just act impulsively trying to do the right thing, even if it doesn't make any sense.
I can relate to that.
Me too.
So he jumps in and he splashes to shore. It's like a full football field length away. The others stay in the boat and they drag the nets across the goal line of the shore.
And when they get there, Jesus is already grilling fish. Where did those fish come from?
Actually, that's a good question. I take that to mean Jesus didn't really need that net full of fish.
Yeah.
Whether they caught fish or not, whether they listened to him or not, whether they came to him or not, he was there making breakfast for them. His care for them, his love for them, did not depend on their action and certainly not on their success.
Kind of like on the hillside, mm-hmm. whether people brought loaves and fish or came just empty-handed. Kind of like you said about the potluck today.
Yeah.
Jesus fed them. You know what that is called?
Are you going to tell me to Google it?
No, Rhonda. It's called grace.
Grace.
And so
the disciples brought in some more fish, and Jesus cooked them along with some bread. And do you know how he cooked the fish?
He grilled it with some Old Bay.
Grilled it with Old Bay. I don't think so. He cooked it over, wait for it, a charcoal fire. The last time Peter was by a charcoal fire, what happened?
He betrayed Jesus repeatedly.
And there on the beach by a charcoal fire, Jesus asked Peter with his belly full of fish, "Peter, do you love me?"
He asked him 3 times. And by the 3rd time, Peter got it. He had denied Jesus 3 times, and the risen Christ had given him the chance to set it right, to start again. "If you love me, feed my sheep, feed my lambs, follow me."
Like the days after Easter, these are uncertain, insecure times we live in. And like the disciples, insecure people tend to huddle with folks who think and look and act like them most of the time, and sometimes that makes things worse. They grasp for certainty even when things are uncertain. Sometimes they polarize. Sometimes they vilify folks who think or act different from them. They entrench and they double down on their theories and on what used to make sense. And I get it. It is survival. It is primal. We don't judge it because we all do it.
And today, one of you, us, may be certain that the stock market is going to soar tomorrow. Another one of us may be certain that this is a time the stockpile to toilet paper once again. You may be inwardly torn about the state of the church or have a very clear idea about its direction. You may be fact-checking whether the COVID data and be ready to check to live in on a deserted island somewhere untouched by the global pandemic. We should not assume, though, even in the same church, we're all of the same matter and understand of these matters. That's not realistic.
These are insecure times for us as individuals, for our families, for our churches, for our nation, frankly, for the whole world. And we cannot tell you with any certainty where to point your fishing boat and where to head to shore, or whether to put on every piece of clothing you've ever owned and just jump in the deep end. We can't tell you that. But looking at today's Bible story, we have come up with six things Peter did. And maybe those things are instructive for us. So check this out and see if what worked in his insecure moments might help us with ours.
So first notice that insecure Peter did not stay in hiding. He pushed beyond fear and found it in himself to keep moving.
Secondly, when he moved forward, he did not go alone, right? The disciples came with him. He had his faith community.
Third, he did something familiar to him. You said it, fishing. Something with constancy and durability, something that grounded him.
Fourth, like Dave said, in Dave's theory, Peter reflected on his experiences through the night. He figured out what his own responsibility was, what had been the consequences of his choices. I imagine he let go of all that know-it-all defense. He let that come down and looked deep within himself for a fierce moral inventory.
Fifth, and when he saw Christ already at work on the shore, he went there. I don't know if it so much matters if he did it with or without clothes, bone dry or soaking wet. He went to where Christ was.
And finally, when he went to where Christ was, he saw Christ was already there, ahead of him, waiting for him. Christ fed him. Christ forgave him. Christ told him what to do next. This was grace. So y'all, we're all feeling insecure ourselves this day. We're looking for how the stories of our faith can calm our anxious souls, can give us direction, and remind us of what we do know, what is secure, what we do firmly value.
Like beach and seafood?
No. Like grace and bread broken and shared. So we think this week would be a good time for a spiritual experiment right off the pages of the good book and the pattern of Peter. What if we did some of these six ourselves? This week, let's try these things.
Let's try first, like Peter, keep moving. Don't be paralyzed in the presence of so much insecurity. Hiding won't help. Keep breathing. Keep moving forward.
Like Peter, don't try to go it alone. Here at Greenwood, we have Christian community. We have one another, and we are in the same boat.
Third, like Peter, stay focused on what is sure and even a bit familiar. For Peter, it was fishing. But what is it for you? Do what you know and do it in Jesus' name.
Have a potluck. Plan Bible school. We know what to do, right? Do this in Jesus' name. Fourthly, like Peter, reflect deeply and without defensiveness. Consider how we all got here. Consider your own role, your own responsibility. Confess your sin. Confess your complicity.
Fifth, like Peter, when it becomes clear where Christ is already at work in the world, go there. Join in. Jump in. Don't, like, dilly-dally. Commit.
And finally, know that in insecure times, God's grace is sufficient. Christ risen is what is your solid ground. Christ risen is our security. The Spirit is going ahead of us. Like he says, we call that grace.
So, Rhonda, all of us, what do you think Dickens would say? Best of times? Worst of times?
I don't know what Dickens would say, but I know what Deuteronomy said, because Heather read it to us. Deuteronomy says, I have set before you this day life and death, blessings and curse. Choose life. Choose life so that you and your children and all who follow you may live. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you very much, Reverend Rhonda and Dave. That was a unique style of preaching, but you very relevant to all of our lives because we are there, one way or the other. So as we reflect on their preaching and the message that they brought us today, let us stand together and sing our closing hymn today, Cry of My Heart. We like to sing those twice, two times round, and make that to be the commitment that we make today and every day. Please stand if you're able. May the grace of Jesus Christ, love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you, go with you, and always give you peace. Amen. Thank you.
Don't forget to like and subscribe.